our company is based here in Boston. I came from MIT. I spent a lot of time there, 18 years at MIT, to try to develop new technologies for cities, which includes the electrification of transportation, as well as how we move around in a shared space. Our company is based just across the street. We're literally in the seaport. In fact, you can see from this map that our offices is in the self-driving testing area for the city of Boston. Prior to forming the company, I worked with the city to basically say to them, if you want self-driving vehicles to happen, you need to establish an area for which we can test them. Not only test them, but treat the city as a living laboratory where the technology can be deployed and tested and tried by people. It just cannot be done in simulation, and it can't just be done in a lab. You actually need to try this out. And so we've established the self-driving zone for the city here in the seaport. In fact, we've then placed our offices at the very end of the seaport in order for us to be able to test. And now the company is over, 4 years old. We started in 2015. And the basis of the company is how do we get to full autonomy as quickly as possible? That's really the goal of the company. In fact, let me move forward and think about the market. The market for self-driving vehicles is actually really huge. It's over $7 trillion in the last report. But that $7 trillion is everything from sensing to software to hardware to mapping, everything around that. And of course, there are many verticals and very many horizontals. And you can imagine there are different markets for self-driving as well. In fact, most people, when they think about self-driving, they think about the Jetsons. They think about a small vehicle that can get you from anywhere, from one place to the next, and sort of magically bring you there. But that's not the only way to think about self-driving vehicles. In fact, there is an economic perspective to think about, which is the impact of self-driving vehicles from purely a financial point of view. It turns out that self-driving vehicles, one of the benefits is safety. About 92% of the accidents caused are by human error, by drinking and driving, falling asleep, not paying attention to the road, right? These are all human issues that we have to deal with. And if you compute from AAA, all of the accidents in a year, all the deaths, all of the property damage, it's equal to almost $500 billion alone in the United States. That's just from safety, right? But if the more important or the more economic factor, the bigger economic factor is what is the time savings that I have from not driving, right? If you take the total unit cost of labor, multiply that by the time that you have while you're sitting behind the wheel, that's actually more than the safety that you have, of course. And then there are other things too. If you have cars that drive autonomously, we often brake too early or too late. We accelerate, over-accelerate as well. We don't coordinate ourselves at intersections. Often you'll come to the light, there's no cars there, but you have to wait, and then you have to start up again. So there is the efficiency of autonomous driving, especially if you can coordinate all the vehicles together. There is literally billions of dollars lost in productivity and in cost every year because of this. So from my point of view, the economic impact and the societal impact of self-driving vehicles is tremendous. This is just in the United States alone. Right? And in fact, let me tell you a little bit more about what self-driving cars cannot do today. Right? And we think this is going to take more than a decade to do. And right now, if you wanted to take a self-driving vehicle from here in Boston, let's take Harvard Square. If you're familiar with Boston, how difficult it is to drive in Harvard Square, because those roads were established by the English many, many centuries ago, with cow paths. It's very, very difficult to drive through Harvard Square, even as a human today. Take that car and say, I want to go from Harvard Square to Times Square in New York. I have to cross these two cities, Boston drivers, New York drivers, all the drivers in between, four states, many jurisdictions, and it's very hard to do that today, even under good weather conditions. Right, you're going to have to intervene along the way. There is no car company, no autonomous vehicle company in the world that can do this. Right? Not today. And it's probably going to take a decade or more to get there. Right? In fact, I don't believe that if we took all of the self-driving engineers in the world and put them under one company, we'd be able to do this right now. Right? Just from a technical point of view. And in fact, I think also that many of the engineers we need to do this aren't even in high school yet. Right? We need to educate them to the point where we have the diversity of talent needed to do this technical challenge. And that's just the technical side. There are regulatory challenges, and there are also adoption challenges. When the iPhone came out, not everyone had an iPhone right away. It took years and years, and we're still, the adoption isn't fully there for smartphones. The same thing applies to autonomous vehicles. In fact, if we had an autonomous vehicle today available, it would take about one generation for the entire fleet to also be replaced by that new technology. But that technology doesn't exist yet today. There is no autonomous vehicle that can do everything. We will eventually get here. And even though Elon Musk thinks that it's going to be here next week, it's not going to be here next week. It will take a generation to get there. But we have to work on these things very actively. In fact, this is what we do as a company. There are other new market niches in self-driving. For example, and this is not what we do, long-haul trucks, trucks that cross the country, right? You're going through a very long road. It's very clearly marked. You're traveling for 18 hours, right? There are not many intersections. You're going through an Iowa cornfield, right? And you want to be able to platoon a couple vehicles so that the drivers can take a rest, so that when they arrive to the city, they take over and be able to drive the rest of the way. There are companies that are developing this now that have product in this space that are being invested in and creating revenue. This is a market niche around self-driving. Well, and we don't do that as a company. We don't focus on that higher speed driving. What we do is what we call geofenced autonomy, which is in a specific area under a certain speed, right? Let's take the seaport, for example. The seaport is a district here in Boston, which has a limited area, and typically the speeds are lower. So we can deploy autonomous vehicles today in that area. You can also imagine a university campus, for example, or a corporate office park. These are places that you can deploy autonomous vehicles today. And we can solve some big problems. For example, the first and last mile, right? The first and last mile is, how do I go from where I am to transit? How do I go from my house to the commuter rail? How do I go from where I am to the subway station, right? If you can solve that problem with autonomous vehicles, you can actually create a very efficient and sustainable mobility system for cities today without having to depend on private automobiles to do that, or even private autonomous automobiles to do that. So our view is that these things can be solved today. In fact, let me zoom in a little bit more on this. If you look at this axis, the vertical axis represents vehicle speed. Speed is actually really important, how fast the vehicle is going. The other axis is how complex the environment is. So a city is very, very complex, right? Very hard to drive. It's actually really hard even to predict human behavior, you know, crossing a road, right? And then on the opposite side, you have highway driving, very high speed, but very low complexity. Of course, if you get into a crash, it's probably fatal, right? So speed also kills as well. So we think that the optimal or the sort of sweet spot for the deployment of autonomous vehicles starts in medium speed, medium complexity. That would be a master plan community, for example. There are 152,000 of these in the United States. 9% of the US population lives in a planned community. We don't have that many of them here in the Northeast, but certainly in California and in Georgia and Texas and Florida, you have lots of these. Retirement communities, a subcategory of that. You have 20,000 seniors living in a retirement community. They need mobility just like anybody else does. In fact, they cherish mobility even more than we have because of the lack of it, right? So these are places that you can deploy today. There are 4,000 universities in the United States. There are many more external to that, you know, globally. There are also smart cities, right? You think about the Chinese government or the Korean government or the Saudi government, all of these, you know, in the Far East and the Middle East. These are places that are rapidly urbanizing, and they're designing new cities from the ground up. It's much easier to deploy an autonomous vehicle in a design city as opposed to retrofitting into an old city, like London, for example, or here in the north end of Boston, for example. So those are the places that self-driving vehicles can be deployed today. And we could start building up sort of the tolerance as well as how these systems work. Another example to think about is that your autonomous lawnmower and your autonomous vacuum cleaner are autonomous vehicles also. They're going very, very low speed in this room, half a mile per hour, in a not so complex environment. These are at scale. You can go to the, you know, online and buy a Roomba right now. That is an autonomous vehicle at scale, right, and ubiquitous as well. So our view is that this continuum will start to continue to build over time, and we think this is the logical sort of deployment of that. Our team is from MIT. There's five of us that have done that. I think there's a lot of discussion recently about the DARPA Urban Challenge. In fact, two of our team members, Albert on the right and Sertash on the Albert on my right, Sertash on the far left, these are two guys that were part of the Urban Challenge from MIT's team. There were six teams that finished the race 11 years ago. There were six teams that didn't finish the race. They were also very quality people, too. In fact, all of that group that established the DARPA Urban Challenge from 11 years ago are the sort of pioneers in establishing this technology today. If you look at Waymo or Uber or any of these self-driving startups, the folks that were working on that technology 11 years ago are in positions of authority today to be able to lead that. We have a team that's been focused very much on building that technology. In fact, our expertise is in two areas. I worked on this car. This is the city car. This is the foldable electric car that was mentioned earlier. I worked on that project with the architect Frank Gehry, as well as General Motors. GM had sponsored this project, and the idea was, how do we reinvent the automobile for the city? And one of the things that we looked at was, well, how do we get rid of this parking issue? You know, we're in the city, we can't find a parking space. How do we get rid of that? There's too many cars in the city. It's a lot of congestion and pollution created. How can we think about a shared system, one that saves on space, that is equitable, that can provide access? And we said, well, let's think about a shopping cart. Shopping cart's quite interesting because it's something that you can get at a supermarket, and you can get one anytime you want and bring it wherever you want. And then once you're done, someone else could use it. That was the idea that we had 15 years ago. And we came up with this idea. We built this car. It's a robotic, fully robotic vehicle. Each wheel had its own suspension and braking system in it, which allowed us to control the vehicle completely by wire. That also freed the chassis up so that we could fold the car up. We can fit three cars in one space. And that isn't a license to add more parking. That is the ability to reduce the amount of parking so that we can turn over our city for other more meaningful functions, like more housing for people, more green space for more people, more cafes, all of those things, as opposed to storage of vehicles that do not move, right, most of the time. That's really the idea behind this car. I won this award from Time. And I got to know Sertosh and Albert, who are working on this car. This is the MIT entry into the Urban Challenge. This was 11 years ago. You can see how bulky this car was. In fact, if you look at the trunk of this car, there's $500,000 of equipment in 2007, right? In fact, if you look at the top, there's a little white box. That is an air conditioner that we added to the car because of all the heat generated from the mainframe that we had in that vehicle. The philosophy of the time was, if you can fit in the car, put it into the car, right? Because we didn't know whether we needed all that sensing or not. Now, we were just trying to figure out how to solve the problem. You can see how bulky the sensors are. All the radars on that car, all of the LiDARs on the car, all the cameras were very, very bulky. But fast forward to today, the amount of compute power that we need is basically the size of a video game controller. The LiDAR scanners that we have are the size of maybe 4 or 5 hockey pucks, right? Talking about the Stanley Cup that's happening right now. Right, so all of that is the advancements that we've seen in resolution, compute power, cost, and durability. Although we're not quite there yet on cost and durability, we're going to get there soon. Where you have now an AI revolution on top of that. So the idea was, how do we combine all of that and make a company? Right. In fact, what we do as a company is we provide software. We develop all the software required to integrate all of that sensing, all of that compute, so that the car can understand where it is in the world, how it can localize itself, where it is on the planet, how it can identify objects, classify them, right? Is it a person? Is it a bicycle? Is it a squirrel? Is it a car? Is it a truck? And then infer their intent, right? To be able to understand, is that person going to cross the road? Is that two bicycles? Or is that a tandem bike cross? Is that a parked car or not? Is that car parked the wrong way? Right? How are we going to be able to understand all of the dynamic objects in this space and plan a path through space? Right? That's what we do. That's what all these autonomous vehicle companies are essentially doing. We take that knowledge and we apply it to a set of electric vehicles and we distribute it in a geofenced area. Our company has also been doing a lot of work on testing. We have our own test track. Amazingly, we have our own test track inside our office. Right? This is an indoor test track, which is about maybe half the size of this room. And we're able to build a little Optimus city inside, right? This is inside our offices. And we've also been able to have access to an outdoor test track as well. We have the largest outdoor test track in the United States, which is here in the Boston area. It's in South Weymouth, just 30 minutes south from here. This is where we're able to do all the driverless testing, where there's no one behind the wheel, no operators behind the wheel, so that we can test once you get to full autonomy. Full autonomy is pretty critical because right now, almost all companies have someone sort of sitting behind the wheel watching the wheel. And they'll take over occasionally. For example, in construction, when you have construction on the road, right, we haven't figured out quite exactly how to deal with construction, right? You know, there's a guy there in front of you waving you on, and the computer's trying to figure out, oh, do I go around, or is that a homeless person? Like, how do we go? Do we don't go? How do we figure that out? These are all sort of things that we have to figure out as we start to develop the technology. And I think that's really what the core of what we try to do is. The markets are very interesting from our point of view. There are geofenced markets. They're all listed here. We have focused a lot of our effort on planned communities because the developers of these communities are very practical, right? They want to get the technology out there and look at the kind of benefits that you have. In fact, the first deployment that we did is at Union Point, which is just 30 minutes south of here. It is a planned community. It used to be a former Navy base that was retired. It turned out that 11 years ago, our team had actually tested on this site when it was a military base. And we have returned to the same location to basically solicit a customer. And in this particular site, we have been driving autonomously on this site for over a year already. All of the yellow labeled roads, we have been driving fully autonomously for 12 months through the Boston winter, through fog, through rain, through different conditions. And what we do is provide first and last mile mobility to the commuter rail. So in the morning, we pick people up, and we bring them to the commuter rail, they go to work in Boston, then they come back in the afternoon, and we bring them home. This is not only useful for saving time for the tenants, this is also very useful for people that work at Union Point. Right? There is a retirement community inside of Union Point as well. In fact, the sort of low-wage workers that are coming in, they actually save time and effort to come and work at the senior community there. So we think that this type of autonomy can change the lives of people. If you go there today, there's a fleet of autonomous vehicles that you can have access to. You basically have a cell phone app that you download, and you can access the vehicle. You can basically reserve a vehicle on demand. And a lot of people reserve it because they know when the train's coming. So the 705 train that leaves South Weymouth to Boston, you want to reserve it 10 minutes before. We pick you up and drop you off, and then you go to work. So I think this has become a very seamless sort of thing for the community. And we think that this is actually the beginnings of how you would get autonomy to work. In this environment, we don't go more than 25 miles per hour. We think adoption of autonomous vehicles starts at low speed. Right? If you were presented the choice of getting an autonomous vehicle for the first time, and going 80 miles per hour or 5 miles per hour, what would you do? Right? That's the question, right? 5 miles per hour. And then next week, we can go 6 miles per hour, right? And the following week, we can go 7 miles per hour. And eventually, you get to some comfortable speed. That's what people do as you start to get, you're born, you crawl, you walk, right? Eventually, you can run. We think that the same thing happens with self-driving. In fact, the other way to think about it is that when the first airplanes were created, they weren't Concorde jets. Right, they were bicycles, and then they eventually evolved into that. We don't have Concorde jets anymore, either. And so, our view is that this. Let me go back. Let's see. So that's our first deployment that we did. We have three more deployments coming up. We're expanding. We'll be in three states in addition to Massachusetts by mid-year. We are going to the Brooklyn Navy Yard in New York. This is the first commercial deployment of autonomous vehicles in the state of New York. The second place that we're going is in Reston, Virginia, just outside of Washington, D.C. This is with Brookfield. Brookfield is the largest real estate developer in the world, and we've signed an agreement with them to deploy on their properties and starting in Reston. And the third place that we're going is a retirement community in Northern California called Paradise Valley, which is in Fairfield, California. And these deployments are, the beginnings of the scaling process. The Brooklyn Navy Yard is a private industrial park. It's 300 acres in terms of size. It is very well connected to Manhattan. In fact, the new East River Ferry is coming in. It's already started service very soon. It will connect the rest of Brooklyn to the Navy Yard as well as Manhattan. Right? So this is a sort of river, a water-based transit. What we'll be doing there is providing autonomous mobility inside the Navy Yard initially to provide connectivity from the ferry terminal to the rest of the yard, right? And then to the outer gate so that people can get out from the ferry. That will be done in the first phase because the first phase is within the Navy Yard. It is on private property, right? And then in the second phase, we'll extend beyond that to the transit lines, the major transit lines. If you're from New York, you know that the F line connects into Manhattan, right? There are other lines as well. Those lines are important because the Navy Yard does not want to build more parking. They don't want more people to drive to work. The congestion is outrageous in New York already. You want to encourage new modes of transport and to provide the access that people need to go to work, and to go to where they need to go. So that's why we're doing it in two phases. It turns out also New York has the toughest laws for permits for autonomous vehicles. That's why we have to do it in two phases. We have to prove to people, particularly regulators, that the system is safe, and then they'll allow us to go outside. It's not like we're going to Florida. Florida, they allow you to do anything. So that's actually another kind of another piece of the puzzle is where to deploy technology. In fact, the rules and regulations are very different depending on where you are. The next deployment is in fact, the one I just showed you, the Navy Yard, is starting up in the next few weeks. So within a month, if you go to New York, you can ride an autonomous vehicle. Just call me up and we'll get you a ride. The second place that we're going to in July is with Brookfield. Brookfield, you know, a big real estate developer in Reston, Virginia, which is just outside Washington, D.C. This is an aerial photograph. Half of the site is not fully constructed yet, but there are people that live and work there. And this is a commercial site that will transition into a mixed-use site. It will become retail. There will also be housing there as well. And the new orange structure you see in the corner, that is the new Reston Town Center Metro, which is not finished yet. It will be done in 2020. So we will deploy there starting in July, providing autonomous mobility on the site, and then when the metro opens, we'll connect to that site. This is particularly important for Brookfield because what they want to do is reduce the total amount of parking constructed. About 20% of construction for any development is parking. A lot of that parking is underutilized because it's mandated by local, you know, ordinance or local zoning regulation. Often you'll have one parking space for every apartment. But because of the emergence of Uber and all of these other types of car share systems, not everyone owns a car anymore. And so you can reduce the total amount of parking and use that as an opportunity to put something else and not to have to build that parking as well. This fundamentally changes the economics of how you would do any type of development. And that's because mobility is starting to change it, not the way that you would architect it from a planning point of view. So that's why we're very excited about working with Brookfield. And then with Paradise Valley, this is a retirement community that we're going into. We'll be launching here in September. This is a 55-plus independent living retirement community. It is gated. It is rated at 15 miles per hour. In fact, if you go there today, there's a speed gun when you come in. So if you're at 16 miles per hour, they tell you to slow down in this particular location, right? So it's very, very safe from a speed regime point of view. And everyone there goes to the community center at least two to three times a day for meal programs, right? So you have mixed use, you have independent living, you have all of that in this particular place. Currently, they use human-driven shuttles, right, that the seniors do not like to use because you have to climb the stairs. They're on a loop. It takes a very long time to go around. They don't want to build more parking. They don't want everyone to drive their own car within this community. They want to transition to a driverless system that is on demand, and that will change the sort of entire development process for them. The retirement communities are very similar to this in geography and as well as in character as well. The terrain, the road network, it's all very similar, these 10,000 retirement communities. That's why we think that going there is actually very important for us. Finally, I'll just wrap up by saying that, you know, the technology is present, right? There's been some very famous quotes about how ununiformly distributed the technology is. Well, it is going to be that way. It's going to be concentrated in certain places first, and then it will start to make its way in everyday lives. And I think that, you know, organizations like this are also very important too, because they bring together their thought leaders to think about what the major challenges are. How do we bring people together to be able to solve these big problems? There is a negative outcome that if we aren't careful with, we can create something that we don't want, which is autonomous vehicles that create traffic jams. Right, you can imagine if you had every private car autonomous, that you can create a traffic jam, right? You can create more induced demand because you have now something that works really well, and that will be a negative outcome. What we want to do is move into this new sort of model where you have equal access, you're very sustainable, it's fully electric, and autonomy is the key enabler for this kind of low carbon sort of access. And we think that that's actually plausible if we shape it the right way. That's a combination of engineering work, product development, policy, right, and governance in order to do this correctly. I started a company because I didn't want to work on the academic side. I wanted to actually build something. And that's what we're trying to do here. But it's going to take everyone to kind of pull the boat down the river in order for us to create this. So I want to thank you very much for your attention.